how you perform in sports, how you, and now a big niche for us is how you perform, how gamers are performing. I'll talk about that a little bit. One of the reasons I wanted to get up here, a little bit of self-promotion, is we just published a book about in November, and it's, so glad it's coming so I don't have to remember it, it's a long title. It's called Looking Good, which one of my staff members had come up with, because you ain't seen nothing yet. I was better to see when it was already taken. Looking Good, My Passion for Optometry and the Lives I've Changed, from Digital Screen Time and Esports to Macular Degeneration, from Binocular Vision to Glaucoma to Cataracts and everything in between. We're not only dealing with pathology, which is where a lot of my profession is going, trying to be dealing with retina, trying to deal with glaucoma, trying to deal with cataracts. I mean, ophthalmology does a really good job with that. But we're dealing with binocular skills. I'm dealing with individuals who sit in front of screens all day long, digital screen time is what we call it, whether it be a laptop, desktop, phone, or even just watching television, and the impact it has on your eyes. One of the biggest things I'm dealing with now are gamers and esports. Do most of you know what that is? Yeah, and it is a niche that's getting bigger and bigger. And how would you guys like to be in the business?
Is that Nintendo?
The niche is getting bigger and bigger, and now that individuals dealing with it is almost non-existent. And that's what I'm with right now. So all I got to do is ask my young patients to do a gamer, and their eyes are perked up. And most of them say yes, and that crowd is getting older and older. I want to go over a couple of things in the book. Basically, it's my struggles of getting through and entering optometry school. One of the things that I mentioned I'm pretty proud of is nobody scored, I don't think too many people scored less than I did on the verbal and the SATs and got through optometry school. So much for that test. And I'll keep it clean. And not to do this kind of situation. I was at an optometric insurance meeting yesterday, vision service plan, which a lot of you have. And I definitely gave them an earful, not for their insurance plan, but where optometry is going. But in this also, which is really neat, I described 35 cases, and Amy was one of them. And she said, I can do it because I'm not dilating for you HIPAA police out there. And it's basically one of the best drops for dry eye. Would you say that, Amy?
Absolutely.
And it's called PASIO. It's the stuff you see in advertising, which I know use like Restasis and so forth. That's the same type of drug you would give someone who has a kidney transplant and you're trying to get the body not to reject the kidney. It's an immunosuppressant. This is a mast cell stabilizer and antihistamine, no. Mast cells are in the eyes. When they degranulate, they irritate the heck out of the eyes. This is a once-a-day drop, and I've seen major differences in performance of people with dry eye. And it can be the eyes are watering, dry eye, or just irritated or allergies. It's had a tremendous effect. Other cases that we described, and I know I'm going to talk at the time, so just stop me when we need to stop. The other one was an individual whose life we saved. Person came with headaches and blurred vision. Well, who doesn't come into an optometrist's office with headaches and blurred vision? Except this individual had a blurred optic nerve, which might be some pain, probably not. But what they had was a peripheral vision test, which should be run on every patient. When you look straight ahead of one eye, you see certain spots flashing. This person had a defect in both eyes in the same area. Chance of that happening with the eye problem? Nil. The problem with the person was brain. Not sure what it was, but we immediately referred it. And not only did we refer it, we used my New York attitude to make sure she got down there to the doctor. And she told me, in as much as if I wasn't as strongly suggesting she get down there, she wouldn't have done it. What happened was they saw her, Loma Linda, she had the largest aneurysm they ever seen.
Oh,
she would have been dead in 8 weeks, they said. She was only 46 years old. They did the surgery, ruptured on the operating table, and basically, she lost the eye, but saved the life. The other eye was perfect, and no neurological consequences as a result of it. Wouldn't have been the same. On the other extreme, I dealt with one guy who we fit multifocal contact lenses with. You need 50-year-olds who golf, and you need bifocals. It's pretty tough golfing in a bifocal. But we done it with multifocals, and this statement was, my gain has increased tremendously. He scored doubles matches he was in, And the thing of it is, he was able to see the spin on the ball.
You're stealing my shot, Don.
When he was playing. So that was really neat. I'm really involved a lot with social media. Somebody saw a post I had written. I was back in New York. Individual's mom called me up and said, I thought it's a Christmas call. Merry Christmas. I was in the Bronx. She's in Brooklyn. And I love bringing New York into this stuff. And anyway, what happened was she had a disease called keratoconus. Anybody ever hear of that? If you've had it, you'll know it. It's a disease and thinning of the cornea, where eventually glasses don't work and contacts don't work. Sometimes you have to do a corneal transplant. Cornea's on the front surface of the eye. So there's a new procedure called corneal force drinking, where they pay very expensive because only one company has the patent to put the solution on the eye, but it keeps the eye from deteriorating. And this was as a result of me posting this on social media. And I want to thank Shelby. Where the heck are you?
There she is.
Being able to see Shelby, priceless. Anyway, she runs my social media. I do all the film. I mean, I'll be the one to film, or she'll film me and know what I want to say. I just don't know how to post and monitor the posts. And that's what we use her for several hours a month. And it's been a great thing. And optometry is one of the best professions for actually social media. We even put a post on TikTok, which was really interesting, on vision training for gamers. And we showed how we're doing it. And the thing is, Shelby, how many people we have that actually viewed that?
There was one video that had like 35,000 views.
35,000 views. And how many people liked it? Which is pretty interesting. Not bad for 64 years old putting something on TikTok and having people pay attention.
And about
eyes. So I think that's great.
Right.
And I thought, wait, what are you waving at me?
Yeah, quick question.
Yeah.
If I'm going to buy lens or frames for, if I'm a golfer for the golf tournament, what kind of frame should I buy?
Well, one of the things which is most important for golf, and you won't realize it until you buy them and you actually try golfing, you better make sure you assume a position, a stance, assume a position, I don't want to say that.
Hey, we just said
anyway, I'm making sure you're standing like this and you do not see the rim of the glass when you golf, because that would totally make things really bad. It should be almost touching the cheek without actually touching it, obviously.
Let's get it twice
that
yesterday.
Way you're continuously looking, because if you're like this, Brad, and it stands out and you can see the rim and see below it, and then you see the glasses above it, it would be very disconcerting and you really won't be able to golf. And that's what I would actually say. Another thing very important for you golfers out there, and I think you probably know this already regarding sunglasses, don't use polarized lenses. Because you can't, if you're good, if you're the average golfer, it doesn't even matter. But basically, you can't read the greens. You can't see the shadows and so forth, the green. The water, they're great. But also, don't get polarized lenses if you're in a place that has digital equipment in front of you, because it could actually screen out the information that you're looking at.
See?
Good question, but
yep.
One that's pretty important. Bifocals, that's an individual thing. Most people can't golf with bifocals, but the problem with golfing when you hit your 50s and older is that when you're trying to putt, you got to be able to focus between the pin and where you're looking. And the problem is, that's not a given when you're that age, because you lost all focusing ability. It does take some focusing to look at something 3.5 feet away. That's what multifocal contacts, if they work, they really work. The way they work is there's no up and down. These bifocal wearers out there, you look at the top shelf, you gotta tilt your head back to actually look at something, which you guys know what I'm talking about. This doesn't exist in multifocal. It's just continuous vision. They don't work on everybody, but when they do, they do work. And one last thing I want to be pretty proud of too. My sister comes out every year. She speaks more New York than I do.
From where,
anyway,
Bob?
She came out, and every year I said I'm going to dilate her eyes. And dilation is when you put the drops in, and you want to make sure the back of the eye,
stabilize.
Peripheral retina is clear. As in, what we need to do this. But all of a sudden, when I check for something, and I think in the back of my mind, my cousin had the same problem. You have to look to make sure the person is safe to dilate. And what I mean by that is, there's an area that you gotta look to make sure when fluid drains out of the eye is open. Because if you dilate someone, that's called having a narrow angle. Where the cornea meets the iris, it's like, it's this. There's the cornea and the iris, and the drain's right in that corner. But if it's like this, and you dilate, you totally block off that, and you have one of the worst conditions. And you might want to tell this to friends, because a lot of times it's misdiagnosed, called closed-angle glaucoma. And that's worse, because that's a glaucoma. You feel pain. So if someone goes into a dark environment, all of a sudden, I mean, it can be a number of things, but if they get nauseous or they get headaches and they feel totally lousy, sometimes it can be that that angle closed up. And it would have closed up, because when I sent it back, I sent it to the ophthalmologist, but she went back to Florida, and they agreed. So what they do is they put little laser holes in certain areas of the iris, so that can never happen. So those are things that really make me feel that if it ran in my family, my cousin had it, I might have been thinking that, but we checked that on every patient. I never want to see a closed angle that I caused in the office. And it's pretty scary thing. We've made major difference. One last thing I want to discuss is how we have an impact on life. We had an individual come in, 6, 7, 8 year old kid, came in like this, very dejected. Why? He had lazy eye. In other words, and one eye was like a plug for you people out there, we know your prescription. Was there was about 40 units of difference between the two eyes. Some people know your prescription. So one eye was like a +4, +5, the other eye was perfect. So the eye that was close, I never developed vision.
Okay.
So the best vision, even with correction, is 2200. Can it be trained? Possibly. But the problem with this kid was, one, he was very self-conscious of his glasses, because one eye magnified and one eye didn't magnify. So what happened? He was projected. Put a contact lens on him. You should see the immediate thing, because now the two eyes can deal with each other. Why? Because there's no difference in image size. So even though he was never able to really achieve clear vision, because the brain cells never developed, because he never had a clear image from the retina to the back of the brain, which is called the visual cortex. And but what a difference it made in life. Went out for baseball immediately, went at the Little League, and now he's in the offices training. He can never fly because of the fact, I mean, an airplane is only, doesn't have vision in one eye, and therefore doesn't have depth perception. But what a difference. We've had this in numerous patients whom we've dealt with. And you put contact lenses on 4 or 5 year olds. If there's a medical, that's called medically necessary contact lenses, when glasses cannot do the job. So this is another story, and I have a bunch of other stories in here with patients who we've seen, but I'm gonna wrap this up here because the monitor over there is giving me the high sign. I know I talked a lot more than I should have, but I want to just get one point. This book is on Amazon. Eventually, I'll do a verbal or an audio book.
Board member.
And I'll do it.
Someone pays for a sponsor.
You're going to get 20%
of the night. You only pay for so much time.
As my spin instructor said, they don't pay me for clean downloads.
I know. I'm playing with you.
But it really is. It's dedicated, by the way, to my mom, which some of you have met. And she was an great lady.
Is someone cutting them off?
Dr. Bobby, mom's looking for you. I used to love that. That was Larry used to come up to me. But I'm really proud of her. Cut this short. And again, Shelby, thanks for all you've done for me, because I wish you all this. And you just let me give people who know what the heck you're doing.
Language.
Take care. Thank you.